Hi, good evening all. Today, welcome to our series on the remarkable new book, A New Idea of India, by very talented Harsh Gupta, Madhusudan and Rajiv Mantri. Today, we have a very, very special guest joining us. We have Honorable Union Minister Smriti Irani ji, an articulate politician, a key member of the PM Modi government. And Smriti Irani ji has handled a number of key portfolios in the last few years. Delighted to have you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
So let's get going. Before I ask Harsh and Rajiv to quickly summarize the key themes and the motivation for writing the book, let me please ask a question up front. So your book, the genesis of your book was a series of columns in the Indian Express newspaper and the Mint newspaper, which were triggered by a column on the idea of India by Professor Ashutosh Varshney. So please tell us, Harsh and Rajiv, probably you didn't anticipate at that time that the party that is most closely associated with the Indian right, that is the BJP, would come to power twice. So please tell us, how close do you think the party, the government has been to your idea of India? And Smriti Irani ji, I would like to ask you, how much ideas really matter when it comes to actual governance? So Harsh and Rajiv,
can you please take? I'll take. Thank you, Harsh. You want to go first? I'll take first. Thank you so much, Swati. Thank you so much, Smriti ma'am, for honoring us with your presence in this discussion. Absolutely, you're right, Swati. We had this idea of the book triggered by a debate we had with Professor Ashutosh Varshney in Mint and Indian Express. He had mentioned very specifically that the idea of India, according to him, the Nehruvian idea of India, must see minorities as minorities and not just as individuals. And we had written a few columns about that, against that. We had written a column which got a lot of traction as Narendra Modi as the anti-Nehru, in which we had compared him, in a way, the legacy of Sardar Patel. And those debates happened in multiple newspapers. Nirmala Sitharaman ma'am joined us on our side, Javed Anand joined on the side of Professor Ashutosh Varshney. So to answer your question, firstly, I must say that, you know, while we all understand it, right and left don't really apply to Indian politics that much. I don't see the BJP itself using the word right wing as such that much, because, you know, if we might be very socially progressive. Some of the policies of ma'am with Ministry of Child and Women's Development are some of the most progressive in the world. So your right wing in a Western context of anti-women's rights or anti certain rights is not really applicable to India to that extent. And if somebody is very, very, let's say, anti-women's rights but votes against the BJP, usko hum left-wing bolenge kya? So, matlab, India mein thora sa wo bahar ka context, dharmic context mein apply nahi karta. As far as the BJP is concerned, I think it's been 6 years. I think we've had great policies on both the civilizational front and the economic front. I think we still need to see the results on the economic front in terms of GDP output. But I think the inputs in terms of policy reforms have been excellent, especially in the second term. I think no crisis should be waste. And this government has, during this very, very, very tragic pandemic, done a lot of good steps that should show results. But let us wait for that. Rajiv?
Yeah, so I'll just add on the foreign policy front, actually, if you see the third leg of the Nehruvian sort of construct as non-alignment in foreign policy, I think what we have seen with the Modi government's work in foreign policy is India has become more assertive. It has stood up for its own interests. And I think non-alignment was more of a label. And what was actually happening for all those decades was that India was essentially in the Soviet-Russian camp, in the communist camp of that era. And I think we are making a break from that as we are forging partnerships with democracies like the United States, Japan, Australia, and many other powers. So in, I think in all the three areas, which is economy, foreign policy, as well as the civilizational and social issues, I would say we are making very good progress actually in the last 6 years.
I think both the gentlemen have been very kind, Swati, in their analysis and the way that they have seen the Bharatiya Janata Party progress, or for that matter, the intent with which Bharatiya Janata Party progressed on one, as Harsh and Rajiv have said, civilizational issues, but second, particularly on economic issues. But I'd like to compliment at the onset both the writers, because the header of your book is extremely interesting. normally, if you read about a thought process that was born of the liberal left, or for that matter, those who call themselves centrist, the idea of India pertained to the Indian democratic state or the Nehruvian era. What I love about the book's header is that you call it a civilizational state. And I think that that is where the dichotomy between a civilizational state and, when you use the word India, that's where it lies. So I'll give a very small example, Swati, of why I say that I'm fascinated by the terminology civilizational state. We possibly are the only country in the world where our geographical civilizational history has been reminded to us day in and day out, and we do it very, very unconsciously. A very, very small example. If you are a Hindu and you sit down for a prayer, a puja, what is the sankalp that the Pandit makes you take? The first thing that the Panditji wants you to do is to do Shuddhi. And when you think of Varunde, when you think of Shuddhi, before you begin your prayers, you say Ganga, Sindhu, Saraswati, Yamuna. You invoke the name of Godavari, Narmada, Shipra. When you ask anybody who is involved in the cultural heritage or the legacy of your family spiritually, aapne kahan se sikha? They will tell you they've heard it from generations. Now, in a modern day world, you can talk about technology telling you which geographical area has what kind of a river. Can you imagine civilizationally? We as a nation state were such that a person sitting, let's say, in Tamil Nadu or in Kashmir will invoke the same sankalp. Or for that matter, if you are doing a puja, let's say, in Sikkim, or if you are doing puja in Kutch, if you are doing puja in Delhi, you would have paan ka patta, you will have supari, you will have nariyal. Is that at least an offering that is local to you in, let's say, Delhi? No. Which means, civilizationally, there is something so unique about our country that we don't actually reflect on. Another aspect, every time you have to do a sankalp, you say Jambu Dweepe Bharat Khande. Okay? Which means your ancestors, no matter who they are, have ingrained in you this understanding that this is the geography that enveloped your civilizational state. A continent called Jambu Dweep. A nation state called Bharatvarsh. Then when you invoke further, there is an analysis of time. Today, after this conversation, if you go to somebody and ask, ki sankalp mein Jambu Dweep Bharat Varsh kehne ke baad, hum kya kehte hain? Hum kehte hain ki is waqt jab hum ye sankalp le rahe hain, 28th kaliyug chal raha. Us kaliyug ka pratham charan chal raha hai. Which means, in the sankalp, you are given your lineage in terms of your geography, your time, and of course, then you're told to invoke your name, your gotra. And I'm sure Harsh and Rajiv will agree, that if I talk about gotra, it'll go the secular versus communal debate. However, the intent behind it is that it tells you your genealogy. Nowhere in the world is that practice evident to this day. Which means, and my apologies that I have not read the book in totality, I've gone through some content, which means that when Rajiv and Harsh are using just the header, a civilizational state, that I think is telling about the idea of India today, because it needs to be looked at in a civilizational context. And I think that Rajiv and Harsh, if you start writing more about the Jambu Dweep, the Bharatvarsh, and the trade policies. You see, I believe that there is one chapter in your book about profit, and you talk about economics. Every time there is a debate, and Harsh is right, there is nothing called purely right, purely left in India. Because the left, by its own genesis politically, does not believe in the democratic process. the oxymoron only exists in India, that those who claim as leftists that we don't believe in democracy want to take part in an election so that they can win a parliamentary seat, go and then from the nation state take funds as MPs, as individuals take salaries. So that again is a dichotomy. That's again, for me, it's an absolute hypocritical stand. The second aspect is, and Harsh rightly said, that when you talk about right or conservative,
exactly,
as the political terminology the world over goes, there is a presumption that it is a stand which is anti-women. Now, Harsh has very rightly noted, when you look at the 6 years of Narendra Modi's government, you have a male prime minister talking about menstrual hygiene. And not only limiting himself to talking about it, but actually for the first time setting an administrative protocol as to how state governments and central governments have to ensure menstrual hygiene. Not expected of a man, let alone a right-winger. Today, in a country where we are talking about medical termination of pregnancy, a government which is called right-wing government takes a cabinet decision about a right of a woman on her own body, given her medical condition, to terminate her pregnancy. I am proud as an Indian, one, that my leadership, my cabinet took that decision. Two, men and women in my country did not bat an eyelid about it. And if you juxtaposition this with the Roe versus Wade controversy, you will recognize that for time immemorial, we are told by the Brown Sahibs, who still exist, let's say in areas like Lutyens, Delhi, that tum jo apne aapko right wing kehte ho, progressive nahi ho. Hum jo apne aapko centrist or liberal kehte, hum progressive. These two are telling examples in women's rights that nobody can deny about the Bharatiya Janata Party. And that is why I think there was a debate where even the ecosystem of the right wing said, can we say that we are nationalists? And I think that is an appropriate word. Because when Narendra Modi began the Jandhan Yojana, he did not say sirf unhi ka khata kholo, jo right wing hai, jo majority community se hai. खाता जब खुलता है तो देश के हर नागरिक के लिए खुलता है. बिजली का खंबा जब लगता है तो तार को ये थोड़ी ना कहा जाता है सॉरी एक घर छोड़ के दूसरे घर में जाना. अगर वो घर हिंदू का ना हो वो नहीं होता. सड़क बनती है तो सड़क थोड़ी ना पूछती है आपसे आप हिंदू हो कि मुसलमान हो. सो आई थिंक दैट द कनंड्रम टूडे एंड आई थिंक दैट द वे द हिंदी टर्म फॉर इट इज दिशाहीन ऑपोजिशन की प्रॉब्लम ये है. That they presumed a context under which Narendra Modi will govern. And now they are caught in their own conundrum.
So, ma'am, what is the context you think that the opposition thought that the BJP government will work in? Because the accusation started even before the BJP government came in power. So, just want to know from you.
I had the privilege of seeing this entire churn from Atal Bihari Vajpayee's government. I was 26, 27 years old when I saw their then Prime Minister at close quarters and his functions. And I have had the privilege of serving with Narendra Bhai for 10 years as an MP. And obviously, I've worked within the Sangathan for 20 years now. I think that one of the distinct things that the opposition could not understand about India is that now is not the time where Indians want to be doled out a narrative without Indians debating about it. Wo ji huzoor wala time chala gaya. So when, let's say, Rajiv or Harsh will talk about the Nehruvian approach of politics,
yeah,
what was that approach? Hum jante hain humko kya karna hai? Aap lesser known individuals hain, हमसे कम ज्ञानी है, हम इंटेलेक्ट का एक टेम्पलेट सेट करेंगे और आपको उस रास्ते पे चलना है. एंड एनीबॉडी हु वुड इनवोक इवन अ स्मॉल स्पेक ऑफ डिबेट ऑन इट वुड बी लेबल्ड दैट यू आर नॉट इंटेलेक्चुअल इनफ टू एंगेज इन अ कॉन्वर्सेशन विद अस. एंड दैट सिस्टमिकली बिकेम अ पार्ट ऑफ द पॉलिटिकल थॉट प्रोसेस इन आवर कंट्री. So today's youngsters like Rajiv and Harsh can talk about the Nehruvian faux pas. But we have to admit that 5 to 6 decades in our country, that was the holy cow of Indian politics. Nobody could write or talk about it. Nobody could look at the Nehru-Gandhi clan and tell them to their face that you have plunged this country into absolute abject misery. And that is why one of the chapters, which talks about profit, profit was made a bad word because they could not do enough in terms of policy to help facilitate competition. They could not do enough in terms of policy to help facilitate talent. For them, talent wahi jisko main coupon dunga, jispe main tamga lagaunga, wo talent. So I think the democratization of thought processes happened when Modi emerged because he leveraged technology. And if you remember 2013 or before that, the beauty of Narendra Modi was not that he was only building roads and giving electricity. He was the first Indian politician to say, democratize conversations in our country, use technology, reach out to people, hear them, not once in 5 years, but help engage with them on policy issues day to day.
However, ma'am, a very common allegation on the BJP government is also that it's quite contrary, is that it's anti-intellectualist in nature, like it promotes anti-intellectualism and it browbeat intellectual voices into silence.
Browbeats who? In 6 years of Modi government, which book has been banned?
The accusations are mostly about, through what they say are troll armies unleashed on them, or through investigations started.
The challenge, Swati, is this, that is Swati Goel has a thought process of her own and they can't counter it with facts. They will call you a troll. And honestly, I think we are so done with it that we don't even bother anymore. Because the true hallmark of an intellect or an intellectual is that they can continue to engage in a debate on the basis of fact and not reduce the debater to, I think, using words and analogies like troll army. I think truly a well-read and educated human being is one who gives respect to the ideas and views of the other, even if you do not politically or ideologically align yourselves to each other. So if they call you troll army, that's water off our back. When I hear people say this, I'll be like, kuch aur baat karo, ye wala allegation bada purana ho gaya.
Okay. Sure. Ma'am, also in like continuing with what you and Harsh and Rajiv also said, we have been a civilizational country, and even though we became a nation state much later on, but we have a civilizational continuity. And despite everything, we have kind of existed and flourished. But what is it that continues to paint India as an oppressive and a very discriminatory society? Like, still we have that impression in the global media. How do we move to a more nuanced conversation and debate on these caste and communal relations, and also so that the entire country, the way it is painted, you know, as I said, a very oppressive and discriminatory society, like how do we counter it?
Firstly, Swati, can any nation state in this world get up and say that all is well with them and their society? No. The fact is that we've taken being browbeaten, we have made it a virtue for ourselves. For too long, we've been told to wallow in this self-pity that you are poor. I give a very dangerous example of it. All right? There is something called an HPV vaccine. And it was touted to be used in India. It costs around $1,800. And I've spoken about this for now 15 years. Touted to be introduced into India in the name of cervical cancer. And the beauty of this vaccine is that it does not guarantee you 100% that you will not get the cancer. each dose would cost between 1800 bucks to around 2,500 rupees. So the scare that was mounted about India internationally is that 27% Indian women get cervical cancer. There was absolutely no data, medical evidence found to substantiate that claim. However, because somebody wanted to sell that vaccine, that became the template of all conversations. To this day, as of yesterday, I was in a webinar where a gentleman very humbly said, "Ma'am, we need to do something." I said, "When did you get this data?" "Oh, aaj se 10 saal pehle nikla tha." Maine kaha, "Aapko pata hai kyun nikla tha? Kisi ko vaccine bechna." Another example of nutrition. Sub-Saharan Africa ke saath Hindustan ki tulna ki jati hai. और कहा जाता है सीवियरली एक्यूट मैलनरिश बच्चे हमारे देश में बहुत है। जब मेरे पास ये कार्यभार आया, मैंने कहा कि अगर आज आप हिंदुस्तान के बारे में रिसर्च करें तो कहते हैं सैंड चिल्ड्रन 8 मिलियन है हिंदुस्तान। मैंने कहा एविडेंस दीजिए। देन दे सेड इट्स एक्चुअली एन अप्रोक्सीमेशन। आई सेड हैव यू बीन मलाइनिंग माय कंट्री फॉर इयर्स ऑन एंड ऑन द बेसिस of just a guess? They said yes. So I said, can we reach out to states and ask them that what is your genuine estimation? States wrote back to say it's not 8 million, it's 1.4 million. But still, that's just a guess. It's an approximation. Can you imagine? For the past 2 to 3 decades, your country has been compared to sub-Saharan Africa on the basis of just guesswork. And not proper evidence. And why did that emanate? Somebody thought ki company ka therapeutic food agar hum bech de Hindustan mein to sare bache theek ho jayenge. And when we started conversing, we said, aap gareeb bacche ko agar nourishment dena chahte hain, to aaj scientifically proven kya hai wo nourishment? Humse kaha gaya millets hai. Maine kaha to gareeb ke paas access hai. FCI ke madhyam se us access ko hum sunishchit karenge. हमने कहा व्हाट इज द सेकंड थिंग दे से वी नीड टू मेक श्योर दैट अपार्ट फ्रॉम मिलेट्स वी गिव देम रिच वेजिटेबल्स वन ऑफ देम बीइंग ड्रमस्टिक नाउ कैन यू इमेजिन इंस्टेड ऑफ वर्किंग ऑन दोस पर्टिनेंट इश्यूज व्हिच आर लोकली अवेलेबल वी क्रिएटेड दिस होल एजेंडा बिकेम अ पार्ट ऑफ इट बिकॉज समबडी वांटेड टू सेल अ प्रोडक्ट सो आई थिंक दैट इज व्हाई व्हेन यू लुक एट द कैकोफोनी अबाउट इंडिया The fact that we need to celebrate our poverty. I think that a time has come that people have outgrown that kind of mentality. They want an India which is assertive, however, which is disciplined of its responsibilities, but at the same time an India that seeks evidence for every charge made against it. And I think that is one of the healthiest things about our democratic state right now.
Like data over anecdotes. Here, I would also request Harsh and Rajiv to please comment on the same issue, which is you've also written about how Indians have been living in an inferiority complex for too long, in an idea of India that was thrust upon them. So please comment on how, as a country, we continue to be shown as a oppressive and suppressed, you know, society. So please comment on that. How do you
I'll take a stab at it first. Thank you so much, Swati. Just building on what ma'am said, agar aap oppression ki baat kar rahe ho, I mean, jitna maine ma'am ke baare mein padha hai, ma'am bhi claim kar sakti hai ki she now belongs to a minority family, minority community. She can claim that she's from a different state in North India, worked in Western India, but she won a seat in Uttar Pradesh. America mein aise politicians ko carpet bagger bolte hain. Yes, ma'am, boliye.
Ek do teen cheeze main spasht kar dun. An Indian can never be a minority in her own country.
Exactly, exactly. Ye agar hum Nehruvian language se jaye.
Ideologically, mere yahan pe thodi gadbad hai. Meri dadi Maharashtra hai, dada Punjabi hai. नानी असम से है नाना बंगाल से है पति गुजरात से
है ओह गॉड दैट्स ऑसम व्हाट अ ट्रू आईडिया ऑफ इंडिया
इन द बुक एक्चुअली मैम वी टॉक अबाउट अ पर्सन इंडियन
ऑडिशन के बाद दादाजी आए लाहौर से मुरादाबाद and possibly one of the few people from Muradabad on the Indian political scenes who is not corrupt, but everybody is Robert Vadra. नानी आई बांग्लादेश से पाकिस्तान जो अपना पार्टीशन हुआ उसके बाद दुबरी असम में रहे.
मैम दिस इज
दिस इज व्हाई इंडिया इज व्हाट इट इज.
मैम आई दिस इज सो इम्पोर्टेंट एंड सो टचिंग. आई मीन इन माय ओन केस माय दादी आल्सो केम फ्रॉम लाहौर एंड माय वाइफ्स दादी केम फ्रॉम बांग्लादेश. So very, very in similar, and exactly as ma'am is saying, you know, in our idea of India, we do not want the state to see anybody as a minority. But main jo example de raha tha ki, you know, there is a self-made person who succeeded in the entertainment sector, who went to an area where she did not grow up, but because everybody is accepted as an Indian, did a political kind of coup, you know, defeated a heavyweight in an area called Amethi. So, agar aap isko just to see that as an example. Is that not an idea of new India?
No.
Idea of new India kya bol raha hai? Idea of new India bol raha hai ki log apne caste
an idea of new India till the Gandhi Khandan stamps
it. Wo nahi kar payenge. Wo nahi kar payenge. So you know the old idea of India was bola ja raha tha ki aap jis pradesh se hain, jis jati se hain, aapka wahi lifelong identity hai.
Aur jo profession hai wahi rahega.
आप उसके आगे कुछ मत सोचिए, कुछ करिए मत.
जो परिवार में चल रहा है वही करते रहो बस.
अब वही करते रहिए. अब वो आई थिंक बहुत चेंज हो गया. सो मोर ब्रॉडली ऑन दिस
आइडिया, व्हिच इज आल्सो एन आइडिया, सॉरी टू इंटरप्ट, बट व्हिच इज आल्सो एन आइडिया वी फॉर्मली एंडेड इन ड्यूरिंग आफ्टर इंडिपेंडेंस व्हेन वी मेड आवर रिपब्लिक. वी फॉर्मली अबॉलिश्ड दैट आइडिया
कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनली एंड लीगली. दैट आइडिया वाज अबॉलिश्ड एंड यू आर एब्सोल्युटली राइट. अंबेडकर फेमसली सेड वी आर पुटिंग डेमोक्रेसी ऑन अ हायरार्किकल सॉइल. बट उसको रियलाइज करते करते इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ हुई. अब जब आपकी इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ नहीं हुई, नेहरूवियन स्लो ग्रोथ हुई, उसको बोल दिया गया हिंदू रेट ऑफ ग्रोथ. जब इकोनॉमी नहीं बदली तो सोसाइटी नहीं बदली. बट जस्ट टू गेट बैक ऑन द ग्लोबल मीडिया का आपका जो चार्ज, जो बहुत रेलिवेंट चार्ज है, देखिए एक हिंदी में कहावत है, जब तक लोग आपको गाली नहीं दे रहे आप प्रगति नहीं कर रहे. तो अगर आज ग्लोबली आपको कुछ बोला जा रहा है, 370 आपने रिपील किया, यू स्टूड अप टू चाइना इन डोकलाम, यू स्टूड अप टू चाइना इन ईस्टर्न लद्दाख राइट नाउ व्हिच इज कंटिन्यूइंग. You have taken decisions, triple talaq, Ram Mandir through the judiciary. All of these were assumed ki India apni so-called, agar main Hindi ka ek sarak ka shabd use karun, apni aukaat ke bahar India nahi grow karega. So there are a lot of people who are unhappy ki wo uske bahar grow kar gaya hai. So I think we should not be too worried about global negative reactions. In a, in a way, it's a compliment. It's a compliment hidden inside praise. I think what is important is that we do what is important for our country. Yes, ma'am, please.
I think that we need to also recognize that we are emerging as a nation to reckon with on a global platform. As a citizen, yes, the stand that you take, Harsh, is appreciable. But as a government, one cannot live with that myopic thought. We need to recognize that, yes, we have ushered in reforms in the past 6 years that were unimaginable for any Indian political organization. GST, unheard of that a right-wing government will come through, settle a GST regime in a country as diverse as ours. Segments such as textile, we had 60% of my sector which was never paying tax. That came into a disciplined fiscal structure itself in just one financial year was unbelievable. Agricultural reforms that took place recently in Parliament. And as you rightly said, the abrogation of Article 370, people would never believe it. This Hanji hai manifesto mein kab hoga, or for that matter, Ram Mandir. The fact that the majesty of the Supreme Court could be maintained and at the same time, a judgment given, pure Hindustan mein jis tarah ko kar diya. Now the difference again in our country, and let's say I'm again taking example of the US. I believe in our subject of questions. When the US Supreme Court congregates, they actually congregate for a prayer. They actually congregate for a prayer and then they start. We have no such practice in the Indian Supreme Court, which is something we can be truly proud of. If you look at a dollar bill, it says, "In God we trust." हमारे किसी भी नोट के ऊपर उस बात का उल्लेख नहीं होता. दिक्कत यह है कि लोगों ने सेक्युलरिज्म को अपनी अपनी ओर से परिभाषित कर दिया. secularism was ordained to be separation of religion from state. Now it has become a charge against a religion. And I think that is the problem, that everything gets painted with that brush. Yes, as you rightly said, that there will be noise globally, but that noise is not because India as a nation has faltered. That noise is because there have been subsets of people that have emanated from this so-called unpopularly called non-liberal liberals. Because if they were truly liberal, they would have to take policy reforms like GST or the agricultural reform and actually celebrate it, because they know that this was long pending for India's prosperity.
Absolutely.
I think the problem is not that India is faltering or that we are growing bigger, or maybe they're not able to handle the narrative better. The problem is that those subset of people who have been sitting in those positions for too long cannot now keep pace with this changing India.
Absolutely.
Not enough to be good for an evening out or for a cup of tea. I think that is where the problem is.
Rajiv, I'll just add for 10 seconds. Now, just to add on, ma'am, Supreme Court reference is very important. And the reason why it is so important to understand is, we don't say in any particular God we trust, but hum panth nirpeksh hum dharm nirpeksh nahi dharm in the sense of righteousness and ethics, that is definitely a key part of our identity, our republic, as you know, raw ka bhi dharm, you know, dharm kya Rajiv, raw ka So, you know, dharm is not a word which is anathema to our secularism properly understood. Wo alag baat hai ki aaj ki jo Congress party hai, wo usko waise nahi samajhti hai. But jab wo Congress party 60s or 70s mein, at least us samay unko itni understanding thi ki this is not in any way anti-secular. Yes, Rajiv,
correct. Please. Even the narratives in the Congress party have also quite changed.
They've changed over the years.
A party that actually fought elections by showing cow as a symbol, like, you know, on its flag, and now has brought about a law which effectively harasses anybody who protects cows.
Exactly. Ma'am had said that when we talk of like how the world views us and so on, clearly, you know, just like in any other kind of space, nations don't like competition, right? And for too long, India has been a kind of almost a punching bag, as ma'am very eloquently said. कि कोई भी यहाँ के कुछ भी करे जा रहा है और यहाँ की जो पॉलिटिकल क्लास ऐसी हो गई थी, गवर्नमेंट्स ऐसे हो गए थे कि इनफैक्ट दे आर प्लेइंग अलोंग एंड टुडे वी हैव एन इंडिया आई थिंक वेयर गवर्नमेंट इज विलिंग टू टेक अ स्टैंड इन आवर ओन इंटरेस्ट इन मल्टीपल डिमेंशंस. आई मीन द वे फॉर एग्जाम्पल प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदी स्पोक एट द यूएन जनरल असेंबली रिसेंटली स्टेकिंग अ क्लेम दैट इंडिया नीड्स टू बी अ पार्ट ऑफ द हाईएस्ट डिसीजन मेकिंग स्ट्रक्चर्स इन दैट बॉडी. Otherwise, what legitimacy does that body have? We are here today, where just 15 years ago, or maybe sometime in the UPA one term, I remember the then Prime Minister had actually made a speech at Oxford and said that British rule was maybe not such a bad thing for India. He actually went and said that at Oxford University.
I think what is fascinating is also, I think, from taking off from what Harsh said, that no matter what is the motto of, let's say, the Supreme Court of India, or for that matter, RAW, what is important is that dharma was never anything but a way of life. So, and what is interesting is, between the three of you, you're speaking about the republic called India. But that is another, I think, challenge, that there were republics before we were constitutionally declared as republics. And I think that the challenge comes from the fact that we possibly are the only civilization in the world today, a breathing, living, oldest civilization, that we make feel humiliated, or for that matter, a better word would be embarrassed about our civilizational impact. For instance, if you talk about the word republic, ask any kid today in Delhi or Mumbai, republic kisne likhi, apart from the fact that they think of Arnab Goswami, They will talk about Plato.
Yeah.
They will never talk about the Gana system in our country.
Yeah.
Which means in Buddhist writings, there are excerpts where traders go from North India to Deccan. And when they are to introduce themselves to the king's court, they say, we come through a passage of various republics across north of India. Or for that matter, in Mahabharata, you have Narad coming and telling Yudhishthir how different courts worked, different ganas worked. But actually, we're the only country where the idea of India emanated in a book, I believe, Harshan, correct me again if I'm wrong, in the 1997 or something, which talks about 50 years of Indian independence as though that is what we need to be contracted to. So can you imagine systemically, and the minute I'm saying this, I'm so sure some intellectual get up somewhere and says, Benji ko nahi pata, we were an evolved lot as an idea of India. But truly, if you look at Roman scriptures, or for that matter, Roman trade history, you have in Emperor Augustus' court, ambassadors being received from the Pandyan dynasty. You have Pliny the Elder lamenting the fact that a huge cache of gold is being paid to India. Why? Because we need to pay for our luxury like spices and silk. You have archaeological excavations where joint coins are issued by Roman empires and Indian empires. So today when we're talking about, let's say, the trade history of our country, and you look at it from a modern context, genuinely wo heen bhavna kyun? Heen bhavna isliye, क्योंकि आपको ये याद ना रहे कि आप में क्या क्या ट्रेड की क्षमता थी, मैथमेटिक्स की क्षमता थी, जिसकी वजह से आप एक ऐसा डिप्लोमेटिक वेंचर को जन्म देते थे जो बाकी देशों में सोचा नहीं जाता था. सो आई थिंक दैट वन ऑफ द अदर बुक्स आई होप यू जेंटलमैन वन डे राइट इज द वन द गना सिस्टम्स ऑफ आवर कंट्री द वेरियस रिपब्लिक्स that our country is proud to, you know, have been a part of. And secondly, is the trade policies from the Cholas to the Cheras to the Pandyan dynasties. There was much that needs to be written today in the modern context.
Yeah, absolutely, ma'am. In fact, this has been also a grudge of mostly BJP supporters that the current books in the, yes, the curriculum have not been revised and not the change, you know, to focus less on one kind of history and more on the ancient Indian civilization is not there. So we also hope that revision on that side is done.
I think that we begin now because the education policy, the work began as Prime Minister Modi was kind enough to acknowledge to the entire country. We took 5 years because it was post 30 years that there was a revision taking place.
No, in fact, actually, on that point of India's very old culture of democracy, so in the book we have written about this, that you know, the French philosopher Tocqueville, for example, he observed that in India there was a tradition of collective decision making long before even the label of democracy was invented. And you know, Westerners, obviously, we all know many of the countries that are lecturing everyone on democracy today. They didn't even give adult universal adult franchise when they became sort of adopted the democratic system. So many That's countries right, didn't right. give women voting rights.
We are only taught about the bad aspects of our history and civilization and not. But we also hope that the current government revises the syllabus so as to reflect it and let people study.
Let me just add, Swati. Okay. See, constitutionally, a curriculum will hold only when a policy is in place. And I think that it is to the credit of Narendra Modi that he did not rush it even if he had a so-called brute majority. And I think that's what makes me a proud Bhajpai. He had brute majority in 2019. In 14, he had majority. But he did not subvert constitutional systems, judicial systems, either for the national education policy or for that matter the curriculum framework that is to emanate from it, or for even issues civilizationally, as Harshad said at the beginning of this conversation, like Ram Mandir. The hawa that was created in the country बिकॉज ये लोग आएंगे संविधान को परे रखेंगे, जुडिशियल और जुडिशियल प्रोसेस का सम्मान नहीं करेंगे, करिकुलम आते ही बदल देंगे। नहीं, हमने सबके साथ चर्चा की। पहली बार देश के इतिहास में मुझे से कार्यकर्ता का गौरव है, देश के हम लोग हर गांव की एजुकेशन काउंसिल तक पहुंचे, हर जिले में हमने परिचर्चा की। और मैं गर्व से कहती हूँ कि किसी कांग्रेस सरकार ने आज तक इतनी चर्चाएं नहीं की ग्रामीण अंचल में, जिले में, स्टेट में और फिर नेशनल लेवल। इट्स नेवर हैपेंड, दैट्स हैपेंड फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम।
ओके, and we would have loved to take on this debate and conversation on media narratives versus the lived reality and also India as a civilization, but we'd also move on to other topics. So I wanted to address this subject of socialism also in context of what you did in your ministry recently. You scrapped the handloom board and also invited a lot of flack for it from a section. And this I am taking up also because in this book, Harsh and Rajiv have written quite a bit on socialism and the Nehruvian idea of India, which they say that is defined primarily by three factors: socialism, secularism, pseudo-secularism, as Rajiv corrected me earlier, and non-alignment, which is a very communist idea. So, ma'am, please, if you please share
Scrapped the handloom board because it was not representative of the Indian weaver.
Yeah, that's what.
But became a pit stop for Congress chumchas. I think the difference between Bharatiya Janata Party and the Congress Party is this, and I'm being very blunt about it. We could have easily sustained it and filled it with some chumcha or the other. The fact is, should a board which is not representative of weavers continue to become a source for extracting taxpayers' money only so that they can have chai pani? Or should a non-functional board then be disbanded? I'm so glad that some newspapers had the grace to go out and ask weavers, and they said, "Humne kabhi suna hi nahi tha ki board hamare naam se chal raha hai." And I think the best way to highlight how such boards, establishments became pit stops for Congress supporters or those who would buy some Congress lady sarees or teach some Congress lady dance. I think one of the greatest books to actually uncover this kind of methodology is the P.N. Haxer book, I think written by Jairam Nehru. Every appointment seems, वो नेहरू जी को जानते थे, वो इंदिरा जी को जानते थे, हम उसको जानते थे, इसलिए हमने उसको इस नौकरी पे रख दिया, इस देश का अम्बेसडर बना। मतलब 130 करोड़ के देश में आप एम्बेसडर तभी बन सकते हैं अगर आप गांधी खानदान को जानते हैं। आप सीबीएफसी के चीफ तभी बन सकते हैं, भले ही आप प्रसून जोशी जैसे लेखक ना हो, अगर आपने गांधी खानदान की किसी सुपुत्री को नाच सिखाया। एंड आई थिंक दैट इज द डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन बीजेपी एंड द कांग्रेस पार्टी। इफ यू ट्रूली बिलीव इन मेरिटोक्रेसी, यू कैन नॉट हैव अ होल सिस्टम सपोर्टेड टू बी फिल्ड अप विद चमचास। एंड द अदर इश्यू, दे ऑलवेज से, अरे आपके पास अच्छे लोग ही नहीं है, डिफाइन अच्छे लोग। प्रसून जोशी भाजपा ही नहीं है, सीबीएफसी के चीफ बने। हमने जब शेखर सेन को हमने जवाबदेही दी ड्रामा में, तो वो भी भाजपा को वोट करने वाले समर्थक जाके रैली में भाषण देने वाले व्यक्ति हैं। लेकिन कैन यू इमेजिन, अ प्रसून जोशी नेवर मेड इट टू दैट पोजीशन टिल सच टाइम नरेंद्र मोदी बिकेम प्राइम मिनिस्टर। सो आई थिंक दैट द चैलेंज टुडे इज दैट द नॉइज इज बीइंग मेड इवन व्हेन एन इंडिविजुअल इज नॉट पॉलिटिकली अलाइन बट इज चोजन टू हेड एन इंस्टीट्यूशन फॉर द बेटरमेंट ऑफ इंडिया। द आइडिया बाय द सो कॉल्ड लिबरल्स इज टू शेम देम सो दैट इट बिकम्स अ बर्डन, द हेडेक of being trolled, of being abused, of being belittled. अगर तुम भाजपा के साथ किसी संगठन में काम करो, इसका मतलब तुम इतने पॉलिश नहीं। And I think that is that arrogance that made people give a historic mandate to people to Narendra Modi in 2019.
So, ma'am, you attribute the flak and the controversy over the handloom board scrapping solely to politics.
No, I'm Swati. I have it on paper. I think by now, if anybody's understood Smriti Irani's politics, you know that I never speak without evidence. So when I became textile minister, the first person I called to the ministry was Laila Taiyabji. And I said, can you help me in helping weavers? I said, we have 28 weaver service centers across the country. Could you just take one up so that I can help weavers in that cluster? She didn't turn up. It's on record.
Okay.
So finally, I got fed up of nobody helping. I turned to the students of the Institute of Fashion Technology. And those students delivered. And after all this conundrum, I get a call. Kamse kam humse pooch to liya hota. A democratically elected government needs to call up one Zarina somewhere to say, madam, main kar sakti hu kya? Jiska mujhe constitutional daitva diya gaya hai. What nonsense is that? And unfortunately for me, I don't mince words. That becomes more problematic. Ki ek to tum anpad ho, dusra tum bhajpa se ho, teesra tumne mujhse poocha nahi. And Harsh was kind enough to credit me that I had Gandhi Khandan ki bete ko raha. For them, it's a happenstance. Arey, galti se ho gaya. They would not credit you for creating that history. Arey, Modi ko to vote isliye mil gaya kyunki janta samjhi nahi ki Modi kya hai. Arey. And I think that is arrogance. I hope that keeps prospering in their arena. Because it is with that arrogance that India will keep rejecting them and grow from strength to strength.
Just to add one line.
Yes, Harsh. In fact, I wanted you to speak a bit on socialism and what are the expectations you have from the government.
Yes, absolutely. I'll speak on that. Just to add one line on what ma'am just said about that arrogance. Aaj hi shayad Rahul Gandhi ji ne apne Twitter handle se unhone kaha hai ki desh ki bahut sare deshvasi Muslim, Dalit aur mahilaon ko
महिला भी नहीं बोला सिर्फ मुस्लिम दलित एंड
ट्राइबल्स
नहीं बोला क्योंकि महिलाओं को पीटने में कांग्रेस वाले व्यस्त थे उत्तर प्रदेश में.
तो उन्होंने अब ये बहुत लोगों ने ऐसे अगर आप अपने ही देशवासियों को इतना बिगेटेड मानते तो आप इस देश की राजनीति में क्या कर रहे हैं. अगर आपको लग रहा है कि ये देश
इनकरेजिबल अपना मॉनेटरी साम्राज्य संभालना है हर्ष क्या बात करो जितनी जमीन अभी भी उनके पास है.
बिल्कुल ये बात तो सही है उनका बर्थ राइट आपने छीन लिया. Now on the question of socialism, I think बहुत ये जो famous dialogue नेहरू जी ने JRD टाटा को कहा था कि J don't talk to me about profit. Profit is a dirty word. जब JRD टाटा ने
कहा in your book.
जब JRD टाटा ने कहा था कि आप public sector enterprises द्वारा profit कर लीजिए बहुत loss कर रहा है तो उन्होंने कहा ये profit की गंदी बातें मेरे से मत किया करो. अब ये आज के दिन liberalization के बाद इसकी क्या relevance? इसकी relevance ये भी है कि कभी भी कोई हमारे देश में कोई बात होती है तो लगता है ये बदल गया है भाजपा के साथ लेकिन अभी भी पूरे तौर से सामाजिक और राजनीतिक डिस्कशन में ये पूरा नहीं बदला. कि जैसे कि अभी COVID-19 की बात हुई तो उन्होंने कहा कि आप ऑक्सीजन का प्राइस कैप कर दीजिए. वो कैप लीगली हो गया लेकिन उसके हैंडलिंग चार्जेस ऑक्सीजन के पंप के मुकाबले 3 गुना है. अगर आप बॉम्बे में जाएंगे दिल्ली में जाएंगे सिमिलरली अगर मुझे यूनिवर्सिटी चलानी है मैं IIT का हूँ IIM का हूँ मैं फॉर प्रॉफिट यूनिवर्सिटी नहीं चला सकता लेकिन अगर मैं कुछ ब्यूरोक्रेट्स को जानता हूँ कोई लोकल पॉलिटिशियंस को जानता हूँ तो मैं टेक्निकली नॉन प्रॉफिट बोल के लेकिन अलग से पैसा निकाल सकता हूँ. तो हमारी जो हिपोक्रेसी है प्रॉफिट को लेके वो पहले से काम बहुत हुई है लेकिन अभी भी बहुत तरीके से हमारे देश में मेरिटोक्रेसी और फ्यूचर इकोनॉमिक ग्रोथ को स्लो कर देती है. और इससे क्या होता है कि करप्शन भी और बढ़ती है खाली ग्रोथ स्लो नहीं होती. लेकिन इसका मतलब ये नहीं कि हर जगह में फ्री मार्केट्स और कैपिटलिज्म जरूरी है. हमने किताब में लास्ट पार्ट में लिखा है मैंने राजीव ने आत्मनिर्भर इंडिया आत्मनिर्भर कैपिटलिज्म क्या होता है. हमने बोला कि आप FDI कराइए पूरा सारी बाहर की टेक्नोलॉजीज लीजिए फ्री एंड ओपन डोमेस्टिक फ्री मार्केट करिए. लेकिन अगर टेक्सटाइल्स के अंदर या कोई और मिनिस्ट्री के अंदर जहाँ पे लेबर जहाँ पे एम्प्लॉयमेंट मल्टीप्लायर बहुत है अगर आप कोई एक्सपोर्ट इंसेंटिव देते हैं अगर आप कोई और प्रोडक्शन इंसेंटिव देते हैं PLI प्रोडक्शन इंसेंटिव जैसे सेलफोन्स में दे रहे हैं अगर आप कोई शॉर्ट टर्म मॉडरेट टैरिफ देते हैं तो दैट इज अ गुड आइडिया सो दैट द ग्लोबल सप्लाई चेन्स कैन डिवर्सिफाई आउट ऑफ एन अथॉरिटेरियन कंट्री लाइक चाइना इनटू अ डेमोक्रेटिक कंट्री लाइक इंडिया हमारी भी एम्प्लॉयमेंट क्रिएट हो. तो वी आर नुएंस्ड इनफ टू से कि देयर आर एक्सेप्शंस वेयर वी नीड टू डू थिंग्स बट ब्रॉडली स्पीकिंग आप प्रॉफिट को गंदा शब्द मानेंगे तो प्रॉफिट नहीं आएगा आपके देश में. बहुत एक सिंपल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू है.
ओके बट मे आई ऑल्सो आस्क वन थिंग, ये बात ठीक है कि लार्जर रेटोरिक में और नैरेटिव में प्रॉफिट इज नो लॉन्गर अ बैड वर्ड. इनफैक्ट पीएम मोदी ऑल्सो अड्रेस्ड बिजनेसेस, सॉरी लाइक द हेड्स ऑफ बिजनेसेस, विच वॉज हेल्ड एज अ वेरी रेडिकल काइंड ऑफ अ मूव फॉर अ सोशलिस्ट स्टेट एज दैट इंडिया इज. बट अभी भी ईज ऑफ डूइंग बिजनेस नहीं है, इसके काफी एलिगेशन लगते हैं एंड दीज आर कमिंग फ्रॉम पीपल right on the ground who want to start businesses.
Ease of doing business absolute terms nor better ho sakti hai, lekin hamari rank to 130 se 63 aa gayi hai. Ab aap agree kar sakte hain ki ranking ko thoda better kare, tweak kare, but broadly
like there is an improvement, you say
sab desh ke liye same system
in the right direction.
Ye hum 63rd mein aa gaye, usme do char cheeze hain ki hamari contractual court ka jo part hai wo 163rd hai, wo 100 rank piche hai overall rank se. To hamare contract enforce nahi ho raha hai, hame agla reform judiciary pe karna padega कि हमारे कॉन्ट्रैक्ट जल्दी इनफोर्स हो. सो जी मैम,
सो आई जस्ट वांट टू हर्ष गिव टू इंस्टेंसेस व्हेयर आईड लाइक टू करेक्ट यू ऑन टू एस्पेक्ट्स. वन वाज अ टेक्सटाइल एग्जांपल दैट यू गिव दैट वी आर लेबर इंटेंसिव मार्केट, सो वी शुड बी वेरी वेरी केयरफुल अबाउट द काइंड ऑफ एफडीआई फॉर द काइंड ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज फ्रॉम ओवरसीज दैट कैन कम इन टर्म्स ऑफ मैन्युफैक्चरिंग इन दिस सेगमेंट. टेक्सटाइल में 100% एफडीआई बहुत वर्षों से था. दिक्कत ये थी कि एक एक्सपेक्टेशन है कि आप आएंगे हमारे देश में तो सिर्फ चीप लेबर को एक्सप्लॉइट करने आएंगे, ये हमारी अपॉर्चुनिटी है. दिक्कत ये थी कि अगर आप आएंगे हमारे देश में तो चीप लेबर के साथ अगर चीप रॉ मटेरियल मिल गया दैट इज अ बोनस. माय एक्सपीरियंस इन द पास्ट 4 years इन टेक्सटाइल्स हैज बीन दिस. फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम वी हैव सेड लेट्स डू डीबीटी फॉर ऑल द कॉटन एमएसपी ऑपरेशंस दैट वी डू अक्रॉस द कंट्री. Last year, we did around 28,000 crore, the first ever such huge MSP operation for cotton. This year, we will touch around 30 to 35,000 crores in MSP operations.
Wow.
The difference is, in the past 3 years, you have never heard a farmer say, mujhe paise nahi hai. Kyun? Kyunki humne kaha ki farmer individually hamare center par aayega. हम फार्मर का थंबप्रिंट, उसका कागज डिजिटली सिक्योर करेंगे और उसका पैसा हम डिजिटली उसी फार्मर के खाते में 72 घंटे में दे देंगे. ये हम 3 साल से कर रहे हैं. ठीक, लेकिन हम फार्मर को अब ये कहते हैं कि अगर तुम एक्स्ट्रा लॉन्ग स्टेबल कॉटन को ग्रो करते हो, उसकी एक्सपोर्ट मार्केट सिर्फ यूएस की $80 बिलियन है. Extra long staple cotton and what a lot of people popularly call Egyptian cotton. We make it, but we make it, I mean, our volumes are much less. But we produce 51% of the world's organic cotton. We've never marketed it. Now we are putting the entire industry. The challenge constitutional is cotton agriculture mein aata hai. So kapda hamare antargat aata hai. So we're pulling and pushing, but making sure that we approach it through certification and compliance. But do we want people to invest in our country, let's say only in the textile segment, because we have lots of labor and comes cheap? No. And I think that's where the PPE story comes in. We have technology time, turnaround time, at least of 38 weeks to 40 weeks in the PPE suit. We were not producing it till March. Our yearly needs for PPE suits across the country, the national need was only 55,000 suits. So in January, when everybody started coming together how to handle the pandemic, we did not have WHO standards of what kind of PPEs to be produced for fighting the pandemic. Can you imagine end of Feb when the levels came, international borders got sealed and we sat together with industry. And when you say profit is a bad word, this is how we, this is the example I'm giving just to give you a comparative. We sat down with defense, we sat down with MEA, we sat down with rail, we sat down with health. That collective team got together and said, agar industry ko janm dena hai to kya kya chahiye? Ek lab chahiye. Ek hi tha Hindustan mein tab. Humne defense ko kaha ki kya aap apne DRDO ke labs ko turn kar sakte hai? This is done. 15 days mein 8 labs were turned around. Phir humne MEA se kaha कि भाई हमारे पास सीलिंग मशीन हिंदुस्तान में नहीं बनती. कपड़े को सील करेंगे वायरोलॉजिस्ट अगर आपको बताएगा वो हिंदुस्तान में मशीन ही नहीं बनती. हमने कहा सब बंद है पूरे देश विदेश में, क्या बस अगर मुझे मशीन जापान से उठानी है या कहीं से उठानी है. आप मदद कर सकते हैं, दिस इज एब्सोल्युटली डन. वी रीच्ड आउट टू इंडस्ट्री, वी सेड तुम्हारे पास रॉ मटेरियल है, दे सेड हां है, अब तक वो वेस्ट जाता था. हमने कहा उसको उठाओ. हमने कहा किस किस के पास मशीन नहीं है, द बिगेस्ट टू द स्मॉलेस्ट इन द इंडस्ट्री मैन्युफैक्चरिंग सिस्टम्स सेड मुझे दो मशीन चाहिए, मुझे 30 मशीन चाहिए. वी मेड लिस्ट, वी मेड MEA कोलैबोरेट सो दैट दे कुड फाइंड मशीन. दे वर कंपनीज वी डिड नॉट हैव मनी. We reached out to companies to say, can you give CSR support to these companies? They said, absolutely. Let's do this. This is the true Indian story of leveraging an opportunity for the greater national good. But China se jo PPE suit 2200 rupay mein aata tha, aaj Hindustan mein 200 rupay ka banta hai, level 4 ka. Aur jis desh mein April ke mahine mein ek company nahi thi, aaj jab hum baat kar rahe hain, 1200 companies. And to counter Harsh, not a single rupee of subsidy was spent. So all the government did was reform, bringing people together and telling them, if I have to take an Indian train, run it between Phagwada and Coimbatore, I'm going to do it. And ministers calling each other, if your rescue flight is coming, can two of my machines come on that flight?
This good governance.
That sounds great, ma'am.
So instead of a UPI era where two ministers could not even look at each other, in the Modi government, you have ministers picking up the call to each other and saying, "Bol, kya madad chahiye?"
Ma'am, can I also add? Can I also add a related question, which I also asked at the beginning of the discussion? Ma'am, you talk about simple steps that have changed a lot, you know, for the ministry and for the businesses. And how much ideas really matter when it comes to governance?
So let me
what
give
is governance. How yes. So let what me part give, of it is ideas?
No, I'll give you the idea thing in textile only. While this whole busy atmosphere of how to make PPE suits was going on, two things happened. If you dial back a little to the last week of March. Economic Times and a particular reporter carried a story, let's dilute the standards so that we can manufacture, koi bhi manufacture kar lega PPE suits. There was a pressure brought by a lobby. And my officers came together. I said, if this gets diluted and somebody dies, I said, are you willing to take the death of a healthcare professional on your head? They said, absolutely not. They said, lekin ma'am, press ka kya kare? Maine kaha, mujhe aadat hai, aap press chhod do. And in that melee, I had one officer running into our meeting and saying, I have an idea. I said, about PP? He said, no, about that swab. I said, what? He said, nasal swab. He started studying how that nasal swab could be made in India. He said, ma'am, aap mujhe Johnson & Johnson company se wo earbud dilwa doge. Uska beech ka plastic ka danda hai, mujhe wo chahiye. Then he said another company ka waste hai, plastic waste. Wo waste us swab ka pehla aage ka hissa ban sakta hai. I said, ab waste hum le aayenge, earbud ka aur danda le aayenge, banayega kaun? We got in touch with the Institute of Virology in Pune. We got in touch with two MSMEs. We said, we are willing to take a chance on this idea that an officer had suddenly in an evening rush. They said, we'll support it. And today, जो 10 रुपए का स्वाब मिलता था चाइना से, आज वो 17 पैसे का बन रहा है हिंदुस्तान में. सो दैट्स व्हेन स्वाति, व्हेन यू सेड हाउ मच एन आइडिया मैटर्स, आई थिंक व्हाट मैटर्स इज व्हेन आइडिया गेट्स लीडरशिप सपोर्ट, व्हेन आइडिया गेट्स गवर्नेंस सपोर्ट, देन यू सी. बिकॉज इंडियंस आर टेम्परमेंटली नॉट जुगाड़ू, एंटरप्रेन्योरियल इन नेचर. And the Prime Minister says this time and again, get out of the way, do not become gatirodh mat ban. I think that's what the government tries to do. It talks of ease of doing business and ease of living.
We are so glad that you are actually talking against Jugaad, because that's been glorified beyond redemption now.
What?
That Jugaad ko itna glorify kiya gaya hai abhi tak, ki jaise ek
audience
ka...
आई डोंट थिंक हर शब्द से कोई दिक्कत है, बट उस शब्द के पीछे शायद मंशा ये थी कि जुगाड़ वो है जो सस्टेन नहीं करता. तो अंग्रेजी शब्द जब आप एंटरप्रेन्योरियल या एंटरप्राइज की क्षमता के बारे में बात करते हैं तो शायद लोगों को लगता है नहीं नहीं इसमें थोड़ा दम तो होगा।
मैम ऐसे स्टोरीज कम क्यों आती हैं वैसे, जस्ट यू बीन अ मिनिस्टर, यू बीन इन यू आर इन गवर्नेंस, ऐसे जो स्टोरी होती है सक्सेस स्टोरीज, स्मॉल स्टेप्स ट्रांसलेटिंग इनटू सिग्निफिकेंट सक्सेस, ऐसी हम खबरें क्यों कम देखते हैं?
सरकार है ना,
हाँ
अगर गांधी की सरकार होती और राहुल गांधी चीफ नेशनल हेडलाइन बन जाती, मोदी की सरकार
नहीं नहीं बनती, ऐसे स्टोरीज कम आती हैं, ऐसी रिपोर्टेज कम होती है।
आई थिंक स्वाति आल्सो एमिनेट्स फ्रॉम द फैक्ट द प्राइम मिनिस्टर हैज नेवर टोल्ड अस कि गो बीट योर चेस्ट अबाउट हाउ वेल यू हैव डन, ही एक्सपेक्ट्स अस टू डू वेल एवरी डे। यस आई एम कॉन्शियस ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट अ नैरेटिव हैज टू बी सस्टेन्ड, द गुड न्यूज़ हैज टू गेट आउट, बट हैव यू एवर सीन नरेंद्र मोदी चेज अ रिपोर्टर टू से भैया मेरे बारे में लिख दे? नो, दैट इज व्हाई ही डजंट कैरी देम ऑन हिज एयरक्राफ्ट व्हेन ही गोस trips. What matters for the Prime Minister is the fact that you need to deliver for the people of our country, not for yourself or your PR team.
BJP को लेकर बहुत ही contrasting opinion आती है BJP and media relations पे। एक तो बिल्कुल वो नैरेटिव है कि बीजेपी की मुट्ठी में है मीडिया, गोदी मीडिया, और एक बिल्कुल आता है कि इज द मोस्ट अनफ्रेंडली मीडिया, अनफ्रेंडली पार्टी जो कि जंकेट्स पे नहीं लेके जाती, जो कि प्रेस कॉन्फ्रेंसेस नहीं करती।
आई वुड जस्ट से ऑन दैट, जिन लोगों को पद्मश्री मिला था पहले की सरकार से उन लोगों को नहीं बोलना चाहिए गोदी मीडिया।
नहीं, आई थिंक दैट आई लेट अलोन व्हाटएवर द मीडिया सेज गुड बैड और अगली, आई थिंक एन एस्ट्यूट पॉलिटिशियन is never defined by the politics the media wants him or her to play.
Absolutely.
Because a leader is supposed to lead and not be led by a media report. And I think that if I went by media reports, I would have never gone to Amethi time and again, because according to the media, once you lose a seat, you are supposed to disengage. And even in 2019, when I went to fight, there were so many people who were so sympathetic, अरे बिचारी पांच साल काम किया फिर हार जाएगी. And somebody in the support base said, ma'am, why aren't you countering it? I said, please, उनको इस खुशफहमी में रहने दो. क्योंकि मेरा ध्येय ये नहीं है कि वो मेरे बारे में प्रेस क्लब में क्या बोल रहे हैं. मेरा ध्येय ये है कि अमेठी में मैंने क्या काम किया उसके बारे में जनता क्या बोल रही. So I think we have to be pragmatic about the fact that नरेंद्र मोदी और his government does not envelop its policy from the prism of or from the shackles of the Indian media. See, too long in our country, till an editor doesn't say, with a good pat on your head, you're a very good politician, the politician felt very incomplete. The difference between that era and the Modi era is that the only pat on the back you need is that of your voter. And I think the fact that in the past 1.5 years, you've seen some historical decisions taken, means the voter said between 2014 and 19, you did well. And Modi said, I can do better, give me more. And they did. And he delivered in the first 1.5 years.
Okay. I think Harsh or Rajiv, one of you wanted to say something. I could hear it.
Rajiv, go ahead.
Nini, go first, Harsh.
No, I just wanted to say that, ma'am, or rather the last chapter here. मूवी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है, वो है अबाउट स्टेट कैपेसिटी, क्योंकि हम लोग ने लिखा कि इंडिया में पुलिसिंग अरेस्ट इनकार्सरेशन रेट पर 1000 कंपेयर टू बहुत कंट्रीज बहुत कम है। तो लोग कई बार क्या होता है कि कोई पर्टिकुलर इंसिडेंट, कोई बहुत ही ट्रेजिक इंसिडेंट की कॉन्ट्रोवर्सी में और पॉलिटिक्स में जुड़ जाते हैं, लेकिन आपको क्या लगता है कि पुलिसिंग रिफॉर्म और नॉट जस्ट रिफॉर्म, क्वांटिटी बढ़ाना, जुडिशियल रिफॉर्म, जुडिशियल की क्वांटिटी बढ़ाना, उसी से शायद बहुत सारी सेफ्टी, महिला की सेफ्टी, बाकी लोगों की सेफ्टी का फर्क पड़ता है। जैसे मैंने कहा था, खाली ये सेफ्टी की बात नहीं है, कमर्शियल कॉन्ट्रैक्ट भी जो है, आज के दिन अगर जुडिशरी होगी तो मैं कोई और कम्युनिटी के साथ बिजनेस कर सकता हूँ, मैं खाली अपनी कम्युनिटी में बिजनेस नहीं करूंगा, क्योंकि वो पेपर उस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट की कोई अहमियत है नहीं। तो अभी क्या है कि खाली अपने ही समाज में लोग धंधा करते हैं, इसको कैसे बदला जाए?
आप आर्बिट्रेशन और कॉन्ट्रैक्ट लॉ के इन्फोर्समेंट के संदर्भ में जब चिंता व्यक्त करते हैं, जो एक आपको एग्जांपल दे रही हूं, आप लोग इसके ऊपर रिसर्च कर सकते हैं, एनएचएआई ने कंसिलिएशन एक टीम बनाई और कानून पॉलिसी की दृष्टि से प्रस्तुत होना देश के सामने, और इम्प्लीमेंटेशन की जिनके पास जिम्मेदारी है उनका उसको अग्रसर होके इम्प्लीमेंट करना, उसमें बहुत बड़ा फर्क है। एनएचएआई की कंसिलिएशन टीम ने पिछले 3 सालों में 13,000 करोड़ के जो लंबित आर्बिट्रेशन की नीड में केसेस पड़े थे उनको सॉल्व किया। अगेन साथियों से ये बाहर क्यों नहीं आता है, नहीं आता है, सॉल्व किया। नाउ व्हेन यू टॉक अबाउट विमेन्स इश्यूज एज यू हैव enunciated, especially with regards to implementation on the ground. Dial back a little, Narendra Bhai had announced a whole new training prospect for the entire bureaucracy, including the police system. Now, for too long, if you look at the training of personnel in Indian bureaucracy or what the polity has ordained as training, what is that training? Ki aap यूएस चले गए कहीं पर 2 हफ्ते आप स्पेंड करके आ गए, आप ट्रेन हो गए। मैंने कितनी बार एसीआर में देखा है कि जब ऑफिसर को अपनी अचीवमेंट की घोषणा करनी होती है वो अपनी अचीवमेंट में लिखता है कि मैं यूएस में जाके ट्रेन होके आया हूं। अब जब नरेंद्र मोदी की सरकार आई तो उन्होंने कहा आपकी ट्रेनिंग किस लिए हो? एक, अगर आप इकोनॉमिक मिनिस्ट्री में है तो क्या आप इंटरनेशनल ट्रेड और उसके न्यूएंसेस समझते हैं, उसके संदर्भ में क्या आप ट्रेन होना चाहेंगे? दूसरा, विमेन्स इश्यूज पे, ट्राइबल इश्यूज पे या फिर दलित इश्यूज पे स्ट्रक्चरली कैसे सर्विसेज उनको बेहतर मिले, उनका उत्थान कैसे हो, क्या आप उसमें ट्रेन होना चाहेंगे? डिजिटली ट्रेनिंग की व्यवस्था करके और एक ऐसा काउंसिल कैबिनेट की घोषणा स्थापित करके जिसमें सिर्फ पॉलिटिशियन ना हो, ब्यूरोक्रेट ना हो, लेकिन नेशनल सोसाइटल लीडर्स हो, थॉट लीडर्स हो, एचआर लीडर्स हो, जो कहें कि ये पूरा तंत्र हमारी सेवा के लिए बना है, इसको ट्रेन कैसा होना है वो आज हम भी बताएंगे। दैट इज नेवर हैपेंड। तो जब हम ट्रेनिंग की बात करते हैं, बीपीआरएनडी की बात हो जाए या फिर बाकी व्यवस्थाओं की बात हो जाए, लबासना की बात हो जाए, किस प्रकार की ट्रेनिंग हम लोग देना चाहते हैं ताकि वो वैल्यूज ऑफिसर की बढ़ती रहे एज दे ग्रो इनटू द सिस्टम। डिजिटल एक इंटरफेस ऐसा किया है कि ऑफिसर कहते हैं जी आपको जाने की जरूरत नहीं है, यूएस में जाने की जरूरत नहीं है, दिल्ली जाने की जरूरत नहीं है, कुछ चीजें आप डिजिटली अपने आप को ट्रेन कर सकते हैं। और वॉलंटरीली अपने आप को कौन कितना ट्रेन करता है वो भी डिजिटली अब पता चलता है। So I think that you are talking about a country which for close to 70 years had a myopia with regards to how training of officers is to be done. That in India is changing technologically. That today most officers are either engineering graduates or MBAs. These are people who are already trained in an educational institution. They need to be told how to train in administrative reform. And not just be cut copy paste officers. अच्छा मंत्री ने बोल दिया मैं अपने आप को सिर्फ उस मंत्री के उल्लेख तक सीमित रखूंगा या रखूंगी। Can I go beyond that? Apply my years of experience or my education to do something better? I think that's why the officers that the Prime Minister chooses on civil service days, they have a distinct profile of having done different things because they've gone beyond the call of duty and applied themselves. Could you imagine? When lockdown happened, what was the world scenario? 130 करोड़ का देश है, हैराम कैसे संभलेगा? इटली में सड़कों पर लोग लाइन लेकर आईवी की खड़े थे, बेड्स लगी हुई थी। हिंदुस्तान में नहीं हुआ ये। सरकार ने प्रदेश की सरकारों के साथ समन्वय किया, जहां जहां सरकार को लगा प्रदेश की सरकारें वीक पड़ रही हैं, मोदी डिड नॉट बीट हिज चेस्ट, ओ आई एम डूइंग बेटर देन देम, नो। He made sure his minister step in or Dr. Paul steps in to help that state government do better. Because for him, the pandemic was not about politics. It was about saving his people.
Right.
So I think that that is why these are, and I know of SPs and DMs, they had never faced a pandemic. This is the first sitting prime minister of your country who has faced a global pandemic, who has at the same time done an agricultural reform, who has at the same time announced an Atmanirbhar Bharat package, who has then introduced the education policy. It's all happened during the pandemic. So I think that
मोदी सरकार के अगले चार साल में क्या ब्यूरोक्रेटिक रिफॉर्म्स इन टर्म्स ऑफ लैटरल एंट्री इन टर्म्स ऑफ फोर्स्ड एग्जिट अबव द एज ऑफ 55 हाउ डू वी गेट ब्यूरोक्रेट्स टू वर्क बेटर क्योंकि बहुत लोग ऑफ द रिकॉर्ड बोलते हैं कि जी हमने तो ये बोला फिर जैसे वो ब्रिटिश शो है यस मिनिस्टर यस प्राइम मिनिस्टर वो जाते जाते कुछ और बन जाता है वो हवा में खो जाता है सो आपका एक्सपीरियंस
आगे आई हैव वन लास्ट आफ्टर दिस मैम इफ यू परमिट मी आई हैव वन मोर थिंग टू आस्क
ओके सो आई रिमेंबर व्हेन आई वाज इन एचआरडी द देन एचआरडी एंड आई हैव सेड दिस बिफोर समवेयर अ जेंटलमैन वॉक्ड इनटू माय रूम And I think that had more to do with the fact that I was already proclaimed as unpaid by the Congress party. And the gentleman was an IIT director. But what he had done was violate the IIT Act and opened up a campus in Mauritius and started charging $25,000 he had proposed at that time during the UPA era. Now, when I came into office, I said, this is cannot be done. Does not have the mandate of the council. It violates the act. And how can a subsidized regime for students then charge $25,000 to another student because they're outside? So I said, there is an anomaly. It needs to be rectified. The gentleman walked into my room and said, you need to stop this investigation against me. A sitting cabinet minister. Mm-hmm. And I told the gentleman, why would you come and presume that about me? He said, I know fala fala this politician. I said, that's good for you, but the investigation won't stop. So he goes out and he calls that fala fala politician. And he says, aapko pata hai, Smriti Irani ne kaha ki mujhe wo khidki se bahar phenk degi. And itni badtameez hai, aap isko theek karo. So I get a call. Ki bhai, beta, tumne aise bola hai ki isko khidki se bahar phenkogi. भाई साहब एक काम करेंगे अपने पीए को तुरंत मेरे ऑफिस में भेजिए सो पीए कम्स इन 15 मिनट्स ही सेड यस दीदी आई सेड लुक अराउंड एट माय ऑफिस आई सेड डू यू सी अ विंडो ही सेड देयर इज एनी नाउ कम बैक इन 7 डेज आई कॉल्ड अप सीपीडब्ल्यूडी मैंने कल सुबह से मेरे ऑफिस में दो विंडोज बनाओ एंड आई कॉल्ड दैट गाय बैक दैट डायरेक्टर हु केम टॉन्टमिंग मैंने कहा आप 8वें दिन प्रस्तुत हुई है Eighth day, the gentleman walks in. He said, so have you changed your mind, Mrs. Irani? I said, no, no, I've got myself two windows. I said, next time you try this, I will throw you out. So I think that there were attempts when a whole, I think noise was made about Modi having novices and not enough talent. And I think now in the past 6 years that he's delivered on various reform issues, that debate is settled. Insofar as working with bureaucracy, I've been told often that one needs to be very diplomatic. But I think the responsible thing to do is to read every paper, every file that you sign. And for me, I've been blessed with a photographic memory, so no officer can say that that must have missed her. So there is a very famous, and I'm sure Swati has heard this, that when a woman says what, it's not because she hasn't heard you.
Yes.
She's giving an opportunity to change. Right? Exactly. With officers, they know that, oh, ma'am has already read everything and will remember things from 4 years, 10 years ago from a piece of paper somewhere. Including the conversation in parliament, a debate in parliament or the constitution for that matter. So now I have it comparatively easy. But when you're new and you happen to be a right one woman, yes, they are things which are challenging, but they can be dealt with. But I think what Narendra Bhai always tells karyakartas like us is, you have to work with the same system and better it. And I think that the training procedures that he has now professed under the cabinet decision will change a lot in how bureaucracy approaches because we have to recognize it is this bureaucracy that has delivered in the pandemic. And I think that we need to be grateful that they behave not as bureaucrats, but as fellow citizens. And they stepped up to the challenge.
Rajiv, you had one last question.
Yes, Rajiv. Just to close, I think we're also running out of time. So, ma'am, having handled all these ministries, you know, so many policy changes, one sort of kind of orthogonal attack often comes on the government, or I should say orthogonal pushback from the judiciary. And early in the first term of the Modi government, there was an attempt to reform judicial appointments. That is a big part of the second half of the book in terms of reforming judiciary, in terms of reforming how courts work. So if you could comment something on that challenge in terms of how, as a minister, sort of staving off that challenge or managing that challenge. Because very often there has been a criticism of judiciary that they overstep into the job of executive.
I think that, Rajiv, it also at times depends on the kind of affidavits you file. And I'm being very blunt about it. In my 6 years as minister, there were 2-3 cantankerous issues which went up to the Supreme Court. One of them was a German Sanskrit issue.
Right.
And I remember Justice Dave at that time upheld what the government had said. Because I remember the Supreme Court said, what is the stand of the government? And I said, our stand is very simple. German is not the third language of India. Unless somebody changes the whole constitution and tells me so. And the Supreme Court was kind enough to support that fact, irrespective of the misinformation at that time. So I think that one needs to recognize that, yes, the majesty of our Supreme Court is such that irrespective of the bickerings that you hear of, ultimately the executive, the legislative, and the judiciary, they all come together and deliver on the idea of a civilizational state.
Absolutely.
So it is this judiciary that gave you a just decision on Ram Mandir. There will be issues on which you will feel that the judiciary doesn't toe your line. But then the judiciary is supposed to toe the line of the constitution and not us. And I feel that that is what makes India a vibrant democracy. Good, bad or ugly, no matter who has what position, ultimately you can be assured, one, of being heard, and two, of receiving justice.
Fair enough.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, Harsh and Rajiv. We would love to continue this, especially the discussion on judiciary, but we understand that, ma'am, you're running out of time. You, in fact, committed 1 hour, and we are glad that you extended it for us. Thank you so much.